The engine bearings are one of the most critical components in making sure that a high-performance engine is going to remain reliable for a long period of time. Yet I think in the wider engine building world, there's still a misconception or misunderstanding about the technology that is being applied to modern engine bearings. We've got Ron here from King Engine Bearings, and he's going to have a chat to us about some of the technologies that King are using. So Ron, for a start, what is the difference here between your tri-metal and bi-metal engine bearing lines? I've seen there's two different bearing lines you've got there. They look very different visually. What are the differences there?
Well, the major difference is the number of layers of material that are built up to make the engine bearing itself. The tri-metal obviously indicates three layers, and then the bi-metal indicates two. The tri-metal would be, they're both steel backed. Then both the aluminum bimetal and the trimetal, the steel back, and then there's a on the bimetal there's aluminum alloy on top of that steel, and then on the trimetal we have copper lead layer that's on top of the steel, plus a Babbitt layer on top of that. That's really a heavy duty reinforced Babbitt. It's not your traditional Babbitt. It has extra copper for extra fatigue strength, and we're trying to prevent fatigue in the bearing. So that's one of the worst things that happens to a bearing, is it fatigues. So we build all of our product to resist that, to take all the loading that, you know, today's high horsepower engine will give it, so that the bearing doesn't come apart during operation. And so if it were to come apart, it would be catastrophic, you know. So
let's just go back a step. So talking about those tri-metal and bi-metal, when we're visually looking at those, the bi-metal bearing, that has the shinier finish. It looks more like an OE bearing surface.
Yeah. The aluminum bearing, there's a lot of OE bearings made out of that, you know, out of aluminum. We're the only company that has a high-performance aluminum alloy bearing. It's made of, it has silicon blended into the aluminum, plus some other small percentage elements that give it fatigue strength, embeddability, conformability. Another good feature about that bearing is the layer of material is a minimum of 12,000 thick. So it has a lot of depth to absorb debris and also to conform to crank deflection and stuff like that that happened to the bearing.
Now, I think that's one of the important considerations here. When we're looking at the engine bearings, probably from the general population, there's a misconception that we have a contact between that bearing shell and the journal. And of course, that's not the case. We should always actually have a protective layer of oil film. So if we aren't actually having the bearing journal contact the bearing shell, obviously that's what we should be achieving, then why is the embeddability so critical? Why is that an important aspect of a bearing shell?
Well, there's going to be debris develop, either maybe parts that are not clean before they're put together properly, or particles that break off of moving parts in the engine. Sometimes an engine can create its own debris. So we've got to have a material that's going to absorb that and not damage the crankshaft. We'd rather replace bearings than a crankshaft, obviously, for their cost reasons.
So that embeddability allows that debris to actually be trapped in that top layer of the bearing surface, hence protecting the actual journal of the crankshaft?
Yeah, because it's floating around in the oil stream, and as it goes through the gap clearance of the bearing, we want it to be pushed into the bearing material and actually heal itself so it doesn't disturb or interrupt the oil film.
Now, between your tri-metal and bi-metal, there is a difference in the embeddability from what I understand, and also a difference in the load support capability of those two bearing shells. Can you just explain those two differences there?
That has to do with the size of the particle. The tri-metal bearing has a 5/10 overlay. That layer is, of course, obviously very thin. It does its job, but it doesn't have the capability of absorbing anything larger than 5/10. Whereas the bimetal bearing has a lot thicker layer to absorb larger particles and so forth. So it does better in that regard. Also, the conformability is another issue too, because the thin overlay bearing on the trimetal doesn't have that much room for deflection to, you know, where the bearing is worn into, and because the second layer of material is not a really good bearing surface by itself.
So, if I'm reading between the lines there, essentially the tri-metal bearing gives away some of that embeddability for a higher load support capability, whereas the bimetal bearing improved embeddability, so potentially longer life expectancy in a road-going engine. Would that be a fair assumption?
Yes, it would be. Yeah, you've just it's kind of like we've got to be application specific, and anytime we get a call for like what bearing should I use, we always ask, you know, how is the engine going to be used? What's the horsepower? What are the conditions it's going to run under and so forth, so we can really make a good recommendation of using the correct bearing for that application.
Now there's some other features that I just wanted to talk about. In particular, we're using a set of King bearings very shortly in a Subaru FA20 build, and there's a feature that you've applied there, actually a couple of features that you've applied to the Subaru FA20 bearing shells, in particular improving the oil flow through to the big end bearings. Can you just talk about how you've achieved that?
On the Subaru, the number two and number three rod bearing, this is on the EJ and the FA, are fed by one main bearing. So the oil has to be shared from one main. So what King has done is we've designed the main bearings to actually flow more oil to the rods so that they get full lubrication and, you know, we prevent failure. We are just putting more oil there. And that's going to keep the bearing from wearing so bad and actually failing at the end. We put some of the design features are a smart lug, what we call. It's a lug that it has a protrusion on the back, but it does not have an indentation on the ID side.
So what you're talking there, smart lug, your terminology there, you're talking about the locating tang on the back of the bearing shell that locates into the engine block?
Yeah, that's another terminology to use to explain that particular part of the bearing. It's a locating lug is what we generally refer it to. It does nothing but locate the bearing in the housing. The other features that we put in the mains is that we foregrooved that particular position. It actually also fits in number one, so it's number one and number three on the EJ. But we've got the smart lug, we've got foregroove, we've got elliptic oil holes in the groove that supply more oil. And that's the whole key, is getting more oil to those rods.
I just want to go back and just focus again on that smart lug, because it's a subtle aspect, but conventionally when that lug is formed in the bearing shell, it also results in an indentation on the surface that the crankshaft runs against. So your smart lug technology eliminates that, and the upshot of that is it reduces a potential area for oil leakage?
Yes, it closes off the area at the parting line, which could be a potential leak path. And so one of the things we're trying to do is prevent bleed off. And to keep the oil pressure where it needs to be, you need to stop all the leaks. And the smart lug does that. It accomplishes both things, locates the bearing and cuts the leak off.
I just want to change tack a little bit and talk about bearing clearances. And we've seen sort of a couple of different trends between rebuilding a conventional road-going engine and what they're doing in professional motorsport. In professional motorsport, the trend seems to be towards tightening bearing clearances. Generally, I've always been of the opinion with road-going engines that when I'm building high-performance, high-RPM, high-power engines, I tend to err on the side of adding a little bit of clearance. Can you give us your thoughts on those two sort of contrasting techniques?
Well, clearance is a matter of having the right clearance for the application. If you've got really good parts, really stiff components, you want everything to stay true in alignment and so forth, versus parts that maybe are flexible a little bit more, they move around more. That's when you have to determine what your clearance is going to be. But generally, the tighter the clearance, the better for the bearing, because it puts less peak loads on the bearing, as opposed to a lot of clearance, peak loading goes up, which stresses the bearing more. So it's really a balance that's got to be determined by the engine builder. He needs to use experience with it to determine it. But generally, tighter clearances mean less peak bearing loads, better oil pressure, and you also have to match the oil viscosity with that. Because if you use the wrong viscosity with either one, either tight or loose, it could give you some problems.
So essentially, if you do want to run tighter clearances, you do have to be using quality parts that aren't going to be flexing at high RPM and under high load. Otherwise, you're likely to end up with some metal-to-metal contact.
Yeah, that's correct. And preventing metal-to-metal contact is the key to the whole thing. Anytime there's metal-to-metal contact, there's always a probability of problems, catastrophic failure. So we got to maintain that oil film 100% of the time.
Now, one other aspect I wanted to talk about is just transferring heat back out of the bearing shell through the shell into the engine block. How critical is that to the life of the bearing?
That is a very critical part of the function of an engine bearing, is get the heat out of it. Your oil is being sheared. And this is especially true with your tighter clearances. You're shearing the oil more. You're generally generating more heat. So proper contact of the bearing to the housing is vitally important to get the heat out of there. Because if the bearing doesn't do that, it's going to retain the heat. It's actually going to build. And then if it starts building, then the material maybe reaches its thermal capabilities. And it can cause a problem.
Look, it's been really interesting getting some insight into those bearings, Ron. I appreciate your time there. How can our followers find out more about King Engine Bearings?
Anyone that's interested in bearings, and especially King bearings, can go to kingbearings.com. We have a very good website that has a lot of material, a lot of good reading, a lot of technical. Our catalog is electronic. Can also find and look up any King bearing part number, any application that we have parts for. So that would be the best source. Plus our cataloging, our paper catalogs are also available for anybody that's looking up for more information and so forth.
Perfect. Thanks for the chat.
Thank you.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson. You'll learn about performance engine building and EFI tuning, and you'll also have the chance to ask questions, which I'll be answering live. Remember, it's 100% free, so follow the link to claim your spot.